Yes, good evening everyone. Can you all hear me? You can just text yes in the chat box so that we get a confirmation that you guys can hear me. People can hear us. Fair enough. So you can see me, right? All of you. Very good. Welcome everybody. So we'll just start in a minute's time. We have Pushpesh today with us. You know, already I had shared the introduction of Pushpesh. We happen to be college mates.
Tushar, you're on mute.
Oh, I'm really sorry. I was on mute all this while. Never mind. So let's begin. So I'm admitting everyone. So good evening, everyone. So, but then people confirmed that they were listening to my audio. How was that? Anyways, so guys, can you all hear me? Just a reconfirmation because I was on mute for some time. All of you can hear me, right? Just give your confirmation in the chat box so that we can begin. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Chitij, Sri Vaishnavi, everyone. Very good. Welcome to the session, guys. And as we had done last time, we had some discussion on astrophysics and astrobiology. Today, we are going to discuss about computer science in general and one specific field, that is game development technology and things related to that. Okay. So I welcome Pushpesh. Pushpesh happens to be my college buddy. We have studied together in IIT Kharagpur. And today he is the leader of or co-founder of one of the fastest growing gaming companies, right? And Moonfrog Lab. So you can go and check it out on the net, what these people are doing. So you might have heard of a very popular game. So we used to see the ads also. That's called Teen Patti. So I really credit Pushpesh for all of this. So really great achievement to all you and your team, Pushpesh. So welcome Pushpesh to the session today. We call it Centrum Explore. As we had discussed, the agenda is to expose, these students who are in the grades of 9th to 12th, I believe, all of them are there. And basically, we run these talks with an objective of exposing these kids to various vocations and professions which are there, which they can pursue later on. And hence, they can shape up their career profile. So every Sunday or whenever we have a talk, we invite guests like you, expert speakers, and they talk about the profession, the course, their own life journey so far, so that they can get some inspiration from the life stories, as well as they get some inputs to decide on the various professions. And, so last time when we met, we did it on astrophysics and astrobiology. So some experts from Indian Institute of Astrophysics had come down and they enlightened our students about the academic career around it. So today we are going to talk about what you are doing and how our children can decide on how to go about that. So what we'll do is, guys, for your information, this is a Q&A session. So there will not be any presentation or anything. So it will be, few questions we have already, come up with. So we will be discussing that with Pushpesh. And if at all you have any questions, so what you can do is you can just text to me privately in the chat so that I can get the question. Do not send your comments or questions in the common chat box because otherwise it becomes very difficult to manage. So I would request if anyone wants to send a question, he has to send it privately to me on the chat. Is that clear to everyone? So we will be talking, we'll be taking all the questions with all of you, from all of you, and then we'll try to address as many questions as possible. So Pushpesh, over to you. So you can start with your introduction and then we can start discussing the questions. Yeah. Over to you, Pushpesh. Yeah, Pushpesh, can you hear me? So I think.
So I guess team layer for doing this. Yeah, I think that, comparing to your previous conversation or previous talk of astrophysics must have been more interesting. And I don't have any academic kind of advice to give you. I'll rather give my experience or what I think or I've learned or kind of made mistakes during our career, our growth from college to engineering to post-engineering in industries. Whatever I have learned, I'll try to kind of tell the story and hope it helps some of you or kind of resolve some of the doubts, and looking forward to kind of answer any doubts or questions or any specific point in game development or gaming as a career or software development as a career or engineering in general. So just to give background, like I am from Patna. I am from Bihar, Patna, Bihar. My dad is a doctor and he still works in the government hospital over there in Patna. So obviously, like, okay, as born and brought up in a middle class family, right? Like, okay, so again, the same thing, like, okay, expected to follow into, or in a small town, right? You're expected to follow either engineering or medical. Maybe situation is a little better these days, but at our time, that was the only options. And my dad was in medical, so I decided that I don't want to do that and I wanted to go into engineering. So that's how I actually ended up still as a safety net taking PCMB, so physics, chemistry, maths, biology, all of it. And luckily, I was able to clear IIT JEE at that time, which was good. Okay, and then ended up at IIT Kharagpur along with Tushar. We were in the same batch and actually we were in the same hostel also for first year also and the rest of the years as well. So yeah, in Kharagpur, yeah, it's obviously a very prestigious institute. And like, okay, the good part is that okay, you get to, I got to kind of chance to study or kind of live along with the people who are smarter than me or like, okay, who came from all over India and who were much better in different fields, not just academics, but like every single domain that you can think of. And just spending time with them kind of brings the best out on you. Then in computer science standard, I did actually, just to set the kind of context right, I was from state board till 12th. 10th and 12th both. So I actually did not have any computer programming knowledge before getting into IIT. None, like nil, zero. And then in IIT actually is where, due to being in computer science, I had to start learning computer science or programming in general. And it was a slow start, but I slowly caught up. And that was still okay. Like, okay, yeah. So some people were a little advantage to start with, but it did not matter at the end because I started liking it and enjoyed the whole programming part of like, okay, how you come up with solutions using computer programs, right? And then post IIT, I ended up joining an investment bank called Lehman Brothers, which doesn't exist anymore. This was in 2008. So you guys are too young, but 2008 financial crisis was the last big economic crisis in the world. So at that time, and then I realized that, okay, I want to actually go back or not do investment banking, but go back to core tech, which is core computer science and software development. So I ended up joining advertising startup in Bombay. Then from there, I ended up at actually game development company called Zynga. If you guys have heard of it, then okay, that Zynga opened the office in Bangalore and I moved to Bangalore to join it. And then a few years later, I kind of started my own company back in 2013, which is Moonfrog, and where I am still there and like, okay, seven and a half years now. And yeah, it has been a crazy journey. Like, okay, some of the games that we have made, which you guys might be aware of, is Alia Bhatt's Star Life and Bahubali. Bahubali 2 game, which came out along with the movie. So yeah, so those were games made by us. Completely out of India, out of Bangalore, actually, right in the center of the city. So yeah, so that's the brief overview. I think we'll go deeper into specific parts.
Great. So Pushpesh was mentioning that he wanted to always be with people who are smarter than him, but unfortunately, he never knew that he is the smartest of the lot. Anyway, so hence, just to share a small story with Pushpesh, as he was mentioning, we happened to be in the same college right from first year. And I really owe my, in IITs, I keep on sharing the stories that there's something called technology students gymkhana, right? So there's a student's body. So I owe my, election win to Pushpesh of my first year, because he was the person who actually really did a lot of, work for me for campaigning about my candidature and things like that. So IIT life was really great and he was really active. And just to tell you, he is a very good artist. He's a very good at sketching and cartooning and all other stuff. And now somewhat he is doing, he is into career of his choice, where he is adding a lot of value into how, a game interface should look like. Very good. So coming to the specifics of our discussion, Pushpesh, so you head a company which is into game development. Now, almost 99% of the people, barring me, Akhil and Dheeraj probably, who are here as oldies, everyone else plays a lot of computer games today.
Yeah.
And they are nerds in terms of, you know, they are experts. And many times I get inputs of how to, you know, the other day they were talking, seeing the configuration of my computer, they were asking, sir, you should play these kind of games on your computer, right? So hence, coming to this particular field as such, I keep inspiring them that instead of, you know, investing your time into finding the cheat codes of the, you know, the steps and things like that, why don't you invest some time on finding out how to get into creation of such games? So hence, I would like to ask this question to you, that what does it take, you know, so obviously I can understand there are thousands of people who know coding in computer science per se, but then what does it take to be into, let's say, someone who can come up with those games? And you specifically, now you're into mobile gaming, so hence that also. So hence, can you just throw some light onto what does it take to be there in that particular field?
Yeah, so Tushar and team are obviously your teachers, so they are trying to kind of get you aligned to like a more constructive side of the game development, right? Or games in general. I will say this, right? Like, games are very essential. Games are very human part. It's not that, okay, we're taught to play games. Like, we all learned it on our own, and not just you guys, but like us, our parents, our uncles, aunts, like everybody, like it's very human nature. So play games, and you guys are lucky, or like, In the current world, when you can access anything at your fingertips, and you can download games on your PC or your mobile in a matter of seconds, if not minutes. And this kind of access we did not have. So obviously it was much more involved. We didn't even have access to computers when we were at this age, for example, right? So, but at the same time, you have to understand that this is a very easily, too much of anything is bad. Not just games, too much of sugar is bad, too much of oil is bad, too much of everything is bad, right? So it has to be balanced. What I will suggest is this, right? That whenever you are playing a game, and actually it's a little bit more, game is at the end of the day a software which is running on your computing device, whether it's a PC or a Mac or a laptop or a mobile phone, iOS or Android, doesn't matter. It's a software which is running on your operating system or on hardware. If you are kind of interacting with any software, and especially games, because games are more interactive, a lot more active engagement happens, you enjoy, there is aspirations, there is just level ups and storylines and all that kind of stuff. They kind of keep you engaged. If you can kind of align, if you ever want to be a game developer, or if you want to be a better engineer in life, in general, just keep asking, how does this software work? Like, what's happening behind the scenes? I'm not saying that, you will have the answer. The most important part is to ask the right questions. And if you, actually in this world, today's world, if you have a question, you can just go and Google it, and you will find something on Google or Stack Overflow or Wikipedia or somewhere, right? We did not have that luxury, and that's something that I envy these days, or kids these days, that whenever you have a question, you can Google it. Even if your parents don't know, you can still find out the answer. So keep asking the question, how does the game work? What is happening? At least half of you must have played PUBG, right? So what happens? What is the background stuff which is going around in PUBG? You are playing with 10 other people or 50 other people. How is it working? You are on Vodafone, your other friends who are playing along in the same map or same arena, or on Airtel, someone is on Jio, someone is in different city whatsoever. They are not on the same Wi-Fi, still it works. So why it works, what happens? What are the problems you face? Sometimes you will see people drop out. So what happened? Due to bad network. So why will a bad network cause people to drop out? I think the asking questions part, and it's not just limited to games. It's just that if you enjoy games, ask questions about games. Why this works? Why this doesn't work? Can something be done differently? And if you don't play games, then in any other software that you interact with, whether it is some online classes or YouTube or anything, right? Ask questions why it works, why it doesn't work, and then you will find ways to get to an answer. Like you can ask teachers, you can ask your parents, you can ask friends, or you can just Google. So all those parts, but game development, or so I frankly, as a on a personal note, like I'm not a gamer. I enjoy playing casually games on my mobile phone, but not much on PC and everything, because we didn't have access and I did not grow up with that, unluckily. But what I liked in games and why I got into game development is that, okay, it's a very consumer app. Right? Okay. For example, I always want to build software which kind of makes someone happy or serves some purpose in someone's life for some moment. Like, point is, why do you play games? Like, to relieve some tension, to kind of get a break from, like, okay, your studies or academics or whatever, etc., right? To get that 5 minute, 10 minute, 1 hour of full kind of ease out your brain, or kind of take that time off, etc., right? And if you do well, if you kind of go through pass a hard level in the game, if you kind of play along with your friends, then you kind of communicate very openly, effectively, and try to, and it's kind of increases that, all those aspects of it. I love to build that part. I, as an engineer, I enjoyed building that and kind of seeing my players or seeing my users either be happy or sad about it. When the level they wanted to cross could not cross, so they will be sad about it. But still, that's a emotion. So if your software, if your product, if you, whatever you have built, if you built something, like if you're a carpenter and you have built a furniture, if that can draw emotion in the user of that product, that's the best feeling. And that's what you should always aim for. So again, if you like to play games, if you ask such questions, like okay, what's happening behind the scenes, and if you ever want to become the creator of the game or on this side of the table, then you have to empathize with the user and kind of actually genuinely have interest in making someone laugh or cry or something, right? You have to generate that emotion. If your product, service cannot generate emotion, then you have not connected with the user. And games do that very effectively. Obviously, all of you know that. And same thing happens in sports, same thing happens in something else, in any other career that you guys will end up making. So games are exactly that. In game development side of it now, there are multiple pieces, and there are not many game development studios in India, which is, I think that's what lacks in India. There are a lot more software development companies and everything. And games is a software, but still, because we lack that gaming culture in general in school days or in college days or at a professional level. So I think, but India is catching up thanks to the mobile penetration now. So in game development, there are a lot of things. Like, okay, you guys, some of you might have actually thought about it. Like, okay, it requires obviously computer programming. It requires art. Like art, when I say that, okay, UI UX is one thing, like, okay, where you see menu bars and buttons and everything, but then the characters are moving, running, they have emotions. Like, okay, if you've played games on console, like PS5 or PS4, Xboxes, then they are even more kind of grand, right, in their looks and artistic feel. Then there are a lot more hidden things which you don't notice or which generally doesn't come. Like, okay, one is the game design. You, all of you must have noticed that, okay, in some of the games, some levels are so easy, some levels are hard. Sometimes you find it hard, but your friend doesn't find it hard. Your friend finds something easy, you find it very hard, like vice versa. All this is called game design. So it is all designed to be like that. It is not by accident. Everything is designed to be like that. Nothing is of certain attack and defense. Like, it's all those numbers have been chosen by someone. So that's game design. Then there is QA, which is the quality assurance. Games take a lot of time to develop. They have to be kind of tested because they have to work for every single person who ever downloads them. So then there is that. Then there are a lot more fields under these verticals as well. So yeah, like, okay, when someone starts thinking what happens behind this game, how this game got built, like who's behind doing what, then you will realize that how many people it takes to just get one screen or one level done in the game. And that's the nature. So again, it's same as any software. It's like Google Maps or YouTube or Google Chrome or anything that you use. Again, that also takes a lot of people behind the scenes. So more or less that.
Great. So there are a few questions from the audience, Pushpesh, I would like to highlight here.
Yeah.
So the first question, which comes from Aryan, So Aryan asks you, were there any moments in your career when game development didn't work out and you almost felt like quitting? If so, how did you overcome these challenges? So yeah, so for that matter, just to clarify, Aryan, this is not only with game developers, this is with any career.
This is with everything, yeah. So I think it didn't happen with me for game development. Yes, I worked on lots of games or lots of softwares which did not work as intended or did not release, or if released, they did not do well, so they had to be shut down or shut off, etc. So all those kind of stuff happens. But maybe for me, that major decisive moment never came, that the whole career option, I've hit a wall and I have to switch. So not in game development, but when the financial crisis happened in 2008 and I was doing investment banking, and I don't know how many of you understand any of that part, because even people inside investment banking don't fully understand it. It's very hard to align to unless you actually like it. And it will happen to all of you in your career at some point in time. It happens to all of us that we are doing something which we are not fully aligned to. Our heart is not into it. It's not just about the skill also. That also takes programming. This also takes programming. But which programming would you rather do? Point is, programming is not the end of the goal, right? Or the end of the thing. You are not born to do programming. Or you never even while growing up, you should not aim to do programming. You should aim to build things, build products, build services, build companies, build something. Programming is a way to build things. There can be a lot of other ways. Carpentry is one way to build things. Plumbing is one way to build things. And car mechanics or mechanics is one way to build things. And all of these things are okay. Till the time your goals and dreams are about building things. So I was doing programming in investment bank. I did not like what I was building, or I could not relate to it. That did not excite me. So I felt that, maybe I'll not like or enjoy if I remain in this. So financial crisis or the whole period gave me a time to think over it. And then I kind of make that switch that, I want to get to full-fledged software development in consumer space so that I get to build something which I like or which I can relate to, or I'll kind of get more satisfaction out of. And still, at the end of the day, if you look at what I was doing on a day-to-day basis, I was just coding, I was just programming. So that was same, but programming to do what? That was more important. Yeah.
So coming back to this particular very important point you highlighted, alignment with the work you are doing. So recently, J Advanced results were declared, and there was a hell lot of discussions going on that, hey, I prefer computer science. I should be picking up computer science in any second-rated college as well, and even if I am eligible to get into IITs, I will chuck it and probably pick up computer science for the love part of it. And then later on, people realize that, hey, it was a wrong decision. So unfortunately, in India, we do not have a structured mechanism of understanding what fields are what and how what leads to what. So I would like to just ask you here, can you throw light on the computer science as a BTech career itself? Because many people have this. That, hey, I want to end up taking MIT computer science, or let's say IIT Bombay computer science. I want to be there in that elite group, so to say, within quote unquote. So what I'm trying to tell you is, can there be some mechanisms by which, you probably from your experience can share what is computer science all about, and how does one decide whether I'm meant for it? So are there any pointers which can indicate, yes, if you are liking maybe, or for example, if I have to phrase it like this, that I'm a very good student in biology, but somehow I want to get into computer science. So how do I decide whether a person who is really great at, let's say, doing biological sciences, life sciences, am I made for computer science? So how did you decide? Or maybe probably I remember during our time, there was no mechanism either.
Yeah.
So hence today in the current scenario, what should be the pointers to kind of, decide that, here is where computer science will make sense to my life, my career.
So I think that's one thing. When I look back, I think that's one thing I envy, current state or current world, right? At our time, there was no way to figure out, are you meant for, as I said, right? Yeah. Since I was from state board till 12th, I was not taught programming. So it's not that, okay, I had tried it or I liked it or did not like it. Like, I had no data point, like, nothing whatsoever. My whole family, like, okay, or my relatives and friends, nobody had done computers programming at all. Nobody was in that side of engineering. Whoever was in engineering, they were on mechanical, civil, that kind of side, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we did not, I did not have any data point. Like, okay, I kind of followed the same thing, like, okay, which lots of people end up following every year in India, that, okay, oh, computer science.
JEE ranks decide.
JEE ranks decide. Computer science seems like the coolest and everyone talks about it. Like, okay, I think I'll get the best job also from there and all that. Like, okay, so same thing. I also fell into same thing. It's just an happy accident that, okay, I ended up liking what I, and I still don't have an answer. Like, okay, that, okay, if I did something else, maybe I would have liked it more or less. I don't know. Like, okay, frankly, frank answer is that. Now, the second part, like, is there a way to do it now? And how should you go about it? And, like, ideally, like, okay, how should one go about it? So before I get into that, like, one thing I'll say, and which is a very strong statement to say, like, I've worked now, what, 12, 15, 13, 14 years with computer scientists or computer science engineers, right? At all levels, seniors, juniors, batchmates, and, like, and, like, in corporate industry. I'll tell you, like, okay, there is no dearth of computer engineers in India. Like, in Bangalore, even more, like, okay, there are everywhere, right? And I have hired so many of them, worked with so many of them, all that stuff. Not everyone was meant to be computer engineer, who's a computer engineer right now. Not everyone likes it. Not everyone is great at it. Not everyone should have been a computer engineer in the first place. Like, okay, it's just the kind of sad state or in a state, like, okay, it's our education system which pushes people to just go for the glory and, like, okay, oh, you want to sound smartest in your colony or in your locality or in your relatives. So it just becomes like that. But actually, those people don't end up enjoying. Like, okay, it's not that, okay, they have reached the success or wherever they have reached in their career, it's because they were computer engineers. No, like, okay, they might have actually reached better success or more more happier state or more kind of those kind of more, like, career-wise more success if they chose something which they were good at or where they liked. Now, today I will say this, right? Okay, I think most of you have get a chance before you come to the decision point, which is when what branch to take in the engineering, like, okay, in the counseling. Before that, if you can try out programming by any means, by building something yourself, even if your school doesn't teach it, if like, okay, do something, like, okay, just do a YouTube course or a, like, okay, on YouTube also you will find something, or on just you will read some blogs and you can build a very small application. See if you enjoy it. And again, like, okay, don't do programming for the sake of programming. Do it to build something. Like, think of an idea. Oh, I want to build a website like this, or I want to build an alarm clock like this, or I want to build a, say, reminder like this, or a food habit tracker like this, or exercise tracker. So, like, come up with something. There is no dearth of ideas. Actually, if you just Google right now, programming ideas or ideas to build to write my first program, you'll find tons of information, which we never had. I never had. And I kind of look back and I'm like, shit, if that was there, I would have tried it. I would have known for myself, do I like it? Or is it just a peer pressure? Is it just something else? And it's completely all right if you don't like it, because then you are good at something else. You will be. All of us are good at something or other. So it's okay. And that will be a very good test that, okay, do you really need to be in computers, or do you really need that computer science course to help you become a better programmer? Becoming a programmer and joining computer science course are two different things, two independent things. They are not related. Computer science doesn't, like, computer programming is not dependent on doing computer science course. Computer science course might help you become a better programmer, but it's not a mandatory condition. It's not a necessary condition. Yeah. So I've friends from Kharagpur, like IIT, from others, like, okay, outside as well, who are great programmers and better than me, better than lots of people I know. And they have never done computer science. They are not computer science engineers from their respective colleges, nothing. They are just good at it. And they figured out that they are good at it. They practiced and they got better and better and better. So computer science course and computer programming are two independent things. You can choose the whatever department and still be a computer programmer. Like nothing blocks you. In our times, at least, like, oh, we will not get exposure. We will not get the course. So nobody will teach us. Now you don't need to even wait for that. Like, the whole World Wide Web is out there to teach you. So you can learn anything and everything on your own. So I would say it's independent. It's better to just do some experiments on your own if you can. Then you will know that, okay, if computer programming is for you and you will enjoy it in like, okay, longer frame of mind or like, okay, in that sense, but it's all right. Like, okay, some people 10 years later figure out that, okay, oh, maybe this is enough and they want to go back to something else. And that's also okay. When you make that choice, you will make that choice. That's also completely okay. You don't need to be married to something that, okay, oh, this is what I have to choose right now. And then the whole, like, okay, next 40 years, I have to do this. And they're like, no, like the world is different now. You can change it every 5 years if you want to, and every year if you want to. But just decide this, like, okay, whether computer programming is for you or not, figure it out for yourself. And it will be different answers for all of you. Don't come under any pressure. Actually do it to figure out if you like it. And joining computer science course. Now that depends on your exam results, your which college you want to get to. Choosing the college is little independent than the computer being a computer programmer. So I will not say it's a completely this thing that, okay, oh, choose only the best college or choose only the computer science course. It's somewhere in the middle. You have to figure out what you want to be, like where you want to go. Join college for the people, for what kind of exposure you want, what kind of teachers you will get, what kind of students or what kind of friends you will build. And match that with yourself. And that is more important than just choosing a college for a course. Like, okay, no college in the world is going to teach you something which will make you the world's best programmer. It will be something in you. If you have it to be the best programmer, then you will be the best programmer no matter which college you are in.
Great. So I just to summarize what Pushpesh is hinting upon is it's about your calling, whether your innate nature is like, you know, whether you're aligned to programming. So very good, especially those who are in younger ages right now, those who are in 9th and 10th, they can afford trying this out for some time and understand whether, you know, just trying your hands-on on coding will help you or not, you know. So, and it's perfectly fine. Again, I'm telling you that if you don't really like it, it's not that the world is going to come crashing down. Another just example, one example which was, you know, being discussed over here about correlation between computer science as a department, as a course, and being a programmer at the end of the day. So the best example, which I know, and probably Pushpesh will also, you know, acknowledge it, and both of us are juniors to the guy, and he is Mr. Sundar Pichai. And he happens to be a metallurgy engineer by his academics. But and here is what Pushpesh was saying, it's validated that it is there within you, no one can stop you from getting whatever you are meant for. Now, coming to the questions which Shivam is now asking, and the question is, which is the best language for doing coding for a game? That's the first question he's asking. Second question he's asking is, what is a nice platform for beginners which is a nice platform beginners should use for doing coding for a game? So first question is about the language for a game and a platform for coding for a game.
Okay, so I'll answer the second question first, which is the best platform or stuff to use to make your first game, etc. I'll say in today's times, it can be very different 1 year later and can change. It changes fast enough. Today, it will be Unity. You should, if you want to build a game fast enough with simple programming, all that stuff, and you want to see something functional, try it out on your phone, your desktop, Unity is the best and simplest to start with. It's free to start for home use. So yeah, that would be the answer. Now, first question, which is the best programming language to start with to build your first game or build your anything? There is nothing called best programming language. If anybody tells you that, okay, this programming language is better or best, get away from that person a little bit or stop taking advice from that person for programming. Programming languages are a way to write programs. The way programs are something, a way to build a product or do something. Like you want at the end to get something done, right? So programming languages, you can choose what you like. And trust me, if any one of you ends up, or like, okay, some of you will for sure will become great programmers and great computer scientists and etc., you will learn 10, 15 different languages over your lifetime or over your career. So never get married. Don't worry about which language it is. Pick which one you think seems easiest to you. Because again, like, okay, programming language and programming language basics are very similar to basic logic. Like when you were studying calculus, when you were still like, okay, some people, or even physics, right? Some people found rotational mechanics or dynamics very easy compared to electrostatics. Some people found integration easier than differentiation, or differentiation easier than integration, vice versa. And it's not that, okay, one is easy or hard. It's because what you find logically, which clicks with you. And programming language is exactly the same. All programming languages, you can do more or less everything. There are a few exceptions here and there, but in general, you can pick Node.js, you can pick Golang, you can pick Python, you can pick C++, like all of them can do all these things what I'm talking about. It's up to you, and it's okay. Great. And don't worry about it. You will change. You will, 1 year later, you will be programming some other language if you are good at it.
Yeah. So what I have learned, whatever limited knowledge about programming is there with me, is that, you know, you'll need to adapt also, because world will change, programming languages will change, new things will come up. So you can't just get hooked on to, okay, I am a very good Python coder, so hence I will die with Python only. So that's not going to happen. So hence, I hope, Shivam, we answered your query. So coming to the next question, Pushpesh, we have from Akash. And he asked, what are the base programming languages that you use? That's the same. So it's a similar question. Acha, the next very interesting question is, on an average, how much money does it take to make one game?
So again, like, it depends on what kind of game, like which game do you want to know about? And it depends, like, okay, bigger companies making a bigger game, then obviously it can take millions of dollars. If a smaller company is making a small game, then it can be much cheaper. Also, it depends how quickly you want to ship the game. You want to build it very quickly, then you need to put more people on it, so there is more cost. If you are okay and you want to take your time and build the game, then it will be lower than that. You know, there is no $1 figure, like, okay, and it depends. If you're building the game in US, the cost will be dramatically different. If you're building it in India, cost will be very different. If you're building it in Bangladesh, cost will be even cheaper.
So I think Pushpesh, he is asking from the personal investment point of view, I guess. Whatever I am getting from him, on an average, how much? So hence, so I think a good computer and Unity, anyways, all these.
All those things are everything. Like, to make a game, to put the game on Android Play Store or iOS Play App Store, all the whole thing, the whole process, end to end, is free. There is no cost. Like the only thing might be signing up for a developer. Hardware cost is there, and signing up for a developer account, which is minimal. And that also, I think, if you are doing it as a student, and if you say that, like, it will be free. So you guys, if you want to, go ahead and do it. And there is no, I don't think there is any limitation or blocker.
But I have a very novice question, because I'm also an amateur coder, to suggest. So one problem we definitely face, because we also keep on using Blenders and Unities of the world. But one thing which definitely bugs us is the rendering process. Yeah. It takes a lot of hardware, time. And especially good hardware has to be there for getting this end product out.
So only for, like, something where you need to do something 3D. If you want to do 3D and you want it to look and feel certain way, then you need to do rendering, and that requires little specific hardware. You can do rendering on the normal commodity hardware as well, but obviously it will be slow and it will take too much time. Like, I know that, okay, in game companies or in our company, like, if 3D hardware we are, or 3D models we are rendering, it takes like even 72 hours sometimes to render. And it's okay. Yeah, but then it requires dedicated, but that is very, like, heavy duty work. For making your own first game, few games, like, okay, there are games which are so simple that, okay, you can make on your 4 GB RAM machines or laptops, like, and games which, like, okay, which are big, which are famous, which a lot of people play in the world. So even games like Angry Birds to Candy Crush, if you play, or if any other match 3 game, like, where puzzles and etc., those are relatively very simple. Like, okay, it's very easy to make them, at least cost wise. Like, okay, they don't require hardware. But if you talk about games like PUBG and, like, okay, where full-on action is happening, there are a lot of motion, then obviously they require a lot more investment. And most probably none of us can do it alone either, because they require teams then who can do art, who can do in art also, like, okay, one guy creates the concept, one guy creates the model, one guy creates the lighting, one guy creates the shading, one guy actually does the rendering. So it's not one person, it's generally five or six people which make that one character look the way you see it. So yeah.
Oh my god, okay, so that is new. Great. So another question is from Aniket Gungara, and he asks, could you ask, this is for me, why sir chose mobile gaming over PC games, since mobile games are harder to develop because like mobiles aren't as strong as PCs? So this is what his perception
no.
is.
Okay, so it's opposite.
Yeah.
So mobile games are not harder to develop. Games are, again, like, come get him, it's software. So software's have very similar level of this thing. Point was that, okay, we were trying to make games for India market, and this is 2013. In India, nobody has PC, and I'm saying that this is a very strong statement, so like listen it carefully and try to, when I'm saying India, like nobody has a PC or nobody has a computer, I'm taking the whole population in picture. Now, we were looking at it, like, okay, so in IIT, when we were studying it, or all of us, like, okay, whoever has studied in engineering college, we have kind of, or like now, whoever's parents have kind of been lucky enough to kind of buy them computers. Rest of India is most probably 95 to 98%, and we are only that 2 or 3%. Yeah. And rest of India got their first computing device in form of a mobile phone.
Yes.
Think of the shop owner next door. Think of like the bus conductor. Think of the shop taxi drivers, Uber, Ola, vendors, to like all the delivery boys these days. Like in general, and like, okay, even in, if you go to smaller towns and villages and farmers, like, okay, they all have now, at least still all of them don't have, but like, at least the penetration is increasing, but not of PC, not of computer, but of mobile phones. And that's why you see everywhere there is mobile phones. All the ads are of mobile phones. All the marketing branding outside on the streets is of mobile phones, because that's what India is. So that's why we did mobile gaming, because we wanted to do gaming for India. So mobile gaming made more sense. If India later turns out to be on some other kind of computing device, maybe some wearable, maybe some glasses, then we will be doing on that. So that's fine.
So I hope, Aniket, you got the, so basically a market-driven call. So it's not that, you know, if need be, it can be done for PC as well. And hence the basics would remain the same. Yes, platforms might change here and there. So hence that was the answer to your question. Next question is from Rahul. And he's asking, what course is the best if you want to pursue game design and development? So I believe this is related to your undergraduate course, which he's talking about. So what course is the best? Yeah.
That's a hard question, and sadly there is no great answer yet. Great answer, because in India there is no good institute which teaches game design. So I would suggest you do it from outside if you're serious about it. You do it from outside India, maybe somewhere in Europe or Canada or places like that. Because they have far more advanced gaming ecosystem, so their teachers, instructors, and just generally, like, the curriculum is a little bit more advanced, and like, you will get more practical knowledge as well. In India, there are one or two colleges, but like, none of them, I think, are at that quality level yet. Maybe with time, it will improve as the industry grows in India. But as of now, I don't know of any course in India which...
Just to add to that, anyways, game development, it has to be a multidisciplinary thing. So hence there will be graphics designers, there will be people who are...
But this was specifically, I think the question was on game design.
Yeah,
so game design is very particular.
Yeah,
which is better done in UK, in Canada, in
Europe. We have courses dedicated for
games. So dedicated for that, yes.
Okay. So you can find out on, you know, so probably we will also try to find out if there are some undergrad courses. And I think if at all there would be courses, maybe they are mostly towards the postgraduate side of it. I'm not sure.
So, no, I think on undergrad side also there is.
Okay. Yeah. Very good. So that we have to explore anyways. Next question is from, good question, by the way. All of you are asking real good questions. Next is from Pranav. So Pranav asks you, when is it too late to move into the gaming industry? And can I take up a career in the gaming industry if I haven't studied CS in college?
Yeah. So, Like as I said, like in gaming, there is computer programmers or game programmers, but then there are lots of other domains which do not require any programming, like art, for example, game design, for example, product management, for example. Like in PUBG, if you are in any game, like if you buy something for 100 coins, why it is 100 and why it is not 99 or 101? So what is the logic? Why it should be that? Why it should not be 50? Why it should not be 200? Why things are laid down in horizontally, not vertically? All these we call product management because they are supposed to be done in a certain way to kind of drive some business metrics, like whatever the business or whatever the game wants to drive. So all this doesn't require programming. These are more management kind of roles and etc. Where normal MBAs, for example, normal product managers, not just MBAs, but normal product managers, like any product manager in a software company, exactly the same. It's again a software, right? So that then there are program managers because there are so many teams in which coordination has to happen. So if you're shipping a game, if you're building a game, it takes 6 months to 1 year to 2 years sometimes, like depending on the size of the game. Then there are 10 people working to 100 people working, or even more. So even in 100 people, how do you coordinate? How do you make sure that okay, someone's work is done before somebody else can work? Right? So there is a lot of coordination required on a day-to-day basis. So those kind of roles are there, which don't require any programming. And you can still be in game development side of the world. You will be in the company which develop games. So that is called game development. Development doesn't mean programming. Development means developing the product. So yes. And when is it too late? There is nothing called too late in career. You are too young. All of us are too young in that sense. You can change career at any point in time. If you think, or if somebody tells you, or society tells you, or anybody tells you that you can, no, if you have to choose now and you can't change it, no. You can change it any point in time, and you should change it when you feel the need to change it, because it is better for your long-term career longevity in general.
And it has to be driven through conviction, not because of any other factor.
And also, like, okay, one thing, right? Look, in today's world, the world is changing so fast.
So fast, yes.
How can you choose a career today which you can predict that, okay, 10 years later, this will be the thing?
So someone who had started coding for maybe the pager
would
have disappeared within
days. Exactly. So if somebody was doing the actual landline phones in India, all that stuff, BSNL was trying to see where they are. Because the world moved to mobile and 4G, and they were BSNL was busy setting up 3G and 2G systems in India. And so things like that will happen to you if you plan that much ahead. Figure out what you're good at and focus on that, and still keep upskilling, keep learning new skills. World is changing very fast in front of our eyes. New technologies are coming. Now 5G is coming. So what does 5G mean? And what will it mean for every single industry, including gaming and every software? Nobody knows. If anybody tells you that, okay, I know, they're lying. Nobody knows yet. So once that happens, so we'll see. Okay. So
adaptability is the key, right?
Is the most important. Yes, you have to keep learning. You cannot think that, okay, oh, I am in college right now, so this is my end phase point of learning, and I learn and then done. My learning is done. Now I have to just use the learning. No, you'll have to keep learning all your life if you want to kind of keep growing in your career or in general.
Great. Thanks a lot, Pushpesh, on that. And then Hariharan is asking, what is the difference, basic difference between software and computer science engineering? So is there any? I don't really know. So
there is, it is like software is the end product. Software is the product, whatever you're building, the package of it, etc. Right? So it's something like, okay, what is the difference between a bottle and metallurgy or material science? Yeah, so that is the basic. If you don't know material science, I should make it using stainless steel or some other alloy or plastic. Those are the decisions. But the software is the product. This is the end product. So computer science teaches you those basics. How? And I'll define it in a way that, computer science is a serious course or a very important thing. Not all the colleges teach it in the right way as well. But computer science teaches you how the hardware and the software, the operating system works and the basics of it. So you should do, whenever you do a computer science course, or if you're kind of choosing that to in your undergrad, try to get through the basics. Like why this works like this? Because again, operating systems will change with time. Like before you pass out, the world will be using some other kind of hardware, some other kind of operating system. But the basics will not change. because okay, how operating systems work, what is a pointer, what are those things, how memories, like, so things like that. So computer science teaches you that, and software is kind of now using that base, those basics to kind of build products actually.
Great. So, okay, moving on to loud. I in fact, now there's a pile up of question now, so we'll have to move a little faster maybe. So who's this? This is Aditya. Aditya is asking, is gameplay programming closely related to AI, artificial intelligence? I think maybe he's asking about involvement of AI and to what an extent it is involved in game programming.
AI is a very is a buzzword that gets thrown around a bit too much these days. And as computer programmer, as computer engineers, we get a little sad by that. A complete misuse and abuse of artificial intelligence as a term. Artificial intelligence or AI is a independent field of computer science, which has application into every single software product that gets built using computer science. So whether it is your operating system on your phone, whether it is a operating system running a hospital ventilator or your car dashboard, to your game, to your YouTube recommendations, all of it has some application of AI. And from actual those Boston Dynamics robots which are running, they are obviously full on manifestation of AI. So in AI, the highest level is called the when
humanoids
can't differentiate, right? The singularity when it happens, that you can't differentiate between
Turing test or something is there.
Yes, so Turing test. Yeah. So obviously that is extreme, but AI's usage is everywhere. Like for example, in Google News or even the news or whatever comes on your kind of mobile phone as the top news articles, behind the scenes, it's doing some AI because it's trying to figure out that, okay, what you will be more interested in. Now that is a very simple form of AI, which can be automated or which can be manually done by someone. Then when manually done, then it is not AI. When it is automated, then it is AI. So games have some application of AI, but it's not that game development is equals to AI. No, AI is an independent thing which has input into every single thing, like your fitness to all that kind of stuff, right? If you are using iPhones and your Androids, etc., they do a lot of AI stuff at both hardware level and software level, which applies to every single thing that you use. So, and there will be more usage of it as we go along. And AI is today, in today's world, what it means is that, since you can't basically process all the information which is out there, so you need artificial intelligence to process it and kind of use it in your products. Because so much data, your heartbeat monitor or your Fitbit is collecting so much data continuously. Now, nobody can manually process that information, right? So then you write AI programs or AI logic to kind of automatically figure out what are the things that you wanted to look at and what are data, and then act on it automatically. So that is AI in today's world.
Great. So going ahead with the question, Chitej, you have asked a question which is resembling the previous one. So front-end language for making a game. I think we had discussed this.
Unity.
And then there was a question from SP who says, which is hardest type of game build? So really don't understand that much. The question says, which is hardest type of game build? So
I also don't understand
SP, to build can you just elaborate on that question? We'll take this question a little later. Next question is again from Akash, who wants to ask, what is the average time invested in a game? Again, I think this is a question which is directly a function of the time, weight you are putting on the game, how much intensive stuff is there. So that will definitely decide the time. I think that's the answer, Pushpresh, right?
Yeah.
Now, good question is, I'm getting a question from, I think this is Venkat, and he's asking, since games are mostly free, how do the company earn? That's really a good question.
Yeah, so that's a good question. So there are, to keep it short, right, there are two ways, actually three ways. The first way is the game is not free, the game is paid. Then you buy it on Google Play Store or Apple's App Store. So the game itself is paid, like Monument Valley or etc. game, if somebody has played it. So that's how those games make money. Second way is advertising. So in games, you might have seen ads, whether banner ads or in between interstitial ads, as we call it. So there are multiple kinds of formats. Mm-hmm. But then that's the second, which is the most common way of making revenue from games. If you have played games on mobile phone, you would notice that. On console games, it's generally the first one because you just buy the game. You buy the game on your PlayStation libraries or etc. or Xbox, right? So that's how those game companies make money, just by you buying it. The third is, which is in-app purchases, as we call it, which is game is basically free. Like even in PUBG, game is basically free, but you buy those season passes, right? Or you buy certain guns, or you buy certain weapons, consumables in the game. And similarly in Candy Crush, if you want to play more, you buy extra lives or you buy extra coins so that unlock a certain level. In PUBG also, actually, you buy certain things to kind of pitch, or in Fortnite, which gives you power during the game. They are all optional things, but you can buy. So those are called in-app purchases. Even in actually PS5 and Xbox games these days, you will see in-app purchases, like in Forza to any Need for Speed, those kind of games, right? You can buy extra, unlock extra cars, for example. You can play with free cars, or you can buy these extra cars or extra bikes to kind of race it properly. Those are called in-app purchases. So if you like the game, so point is, if users like the game and want to play it even better or want to play it even longer with better equipment or weapons in the game, etc., then they pay for it, pay small amounts. And all three ways, some companies use all three ways together, some companies use two of them, some companies use one of them. But these are the primary, all the models of all the gaming companies in the world.
So there are some people who are looking at entrepreneurship related to gaming later on. So that was the question from that perspective, I believe. So the next question is from Lisa, and she's asking, how much time will it take to learn coding? Now, this is okay. I also can answer this, I believe. So there is no right answer again, Lisa. So for example, I am myself trying to learn one coding language since last 10 years. I have not been able to complete it. So all depends on how much time do you have and how...
It's very similar to learning a new language, not programming language. It's like any new different language. If you want to learn Spanish, it depends. It's a direct correlation or direct outcome of how much time you devote to it. And programming languages generally require, again, lots of practice, and generally, I think it's same for every single language. You first do basics, then you pick some real world problems to work on, and then you go through the exercises, start with the easy ones, then go for the harder ones. And then if you keep doing that, then you will get better. There's no one time required, and it depends on the language also. Some languages are very complicated. Some languages are so simple that, okay, whatever you write, it will always work, more or less. So
hence, just to add to that, for example, I did not have any computer science basics either, though I had a fourth subject as computer science in my college, but I had totally messed it up there. So I never paid attention because of our GE pursuits and other things. But, I pursued mechanical, still learned coding on yourself. You have to anyways, whichever department you will be in, you'll have to anyways learn. And hence, in all the IITs for that matter, or for any undergrad engineering course today, you have first year computer science course so that you are equipped with all your tools. So today, computer science, I believe, is more like a tool, just like English for understanding any literature or any scientific document. So hence, you'll have to spend time. How much you can devote, that is the parameter to decide how fast you are learning that. Okay.
Yeah.
So next question is from Kirtan, and he's saying, for cut scenes and are animation studios involved or are animators hired? My God, this is beyond my level. he must be very into all this. So for cut scenes, I don't know what cut scenes are animation studios involved or are animators hired? This is the question. So
both are same, right? Animation studios will have animators, and either a game studio can itself hire animators. So cut scenes are something which comes in the middle of as a break between a gameplay.
So there's some...
So it's exactly the same. So that worked on. Tare Zameen Par animation, for example, worked on Bahubali
movies. Yeah, I think we are having some network.
Or other Rajinikanth movies for animations and those super VFX that you see, right? So it's very similar.
Okay, sorry, Pushpesh, we had lost you in the middle for something.
Sorry, can you hear?
Yes, I can hear you. I don't know. Is the... Okay, anyways. So let's move on to the next question, maybe. And maybe...
Okay.
Yeah. I have a question from Anurag. He says, it is easier to build for iOS or Android? Or, sorry, the question is it easier or harder to build for iOS and Android than for a Windows Unix-based system? This is a question. Yeah, Pushpesh, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Some. I think your screen is frozen. I don't know.
Yes.
Is it because of my internet or what? Just a minute.
Yes, I can. So
Sorry. Go ahead, please. Yeah. So is it easier to build?
Is it fine now? Windows and Linux. Yeah. Windows, Linux, okay. Unix.
Windows, Unix based system coding is harder, Anurag. So that's for you. Okay. The next question is, once we make a good game, is there any method to publish the game, or do we need to make our own platform to publish it?
No, you can publish it on Google Play Store directly, on Android or Apple, App Store, iOS App Store. So yeah, those are, you don't need to publish it or kind of make your own publishing platform. Yeah. You can put games on PhonePe, Paytm, all that stuff, Flipkart also these days. So yeah.
So there are new marketplaces getting developed every...
Yes, there will be always. So,
And
you can
as far as
put
I
it
know,
on Steam. Yeah. Yeah. If you are in PC gaming, you can put it on Steam. There is no problem.
Yeah, so it all depends on how much money do you want to pay or invest and how much reach do you want to have initially. So
and
obviously
what kind of game it is. Yeah. Exactly. Whom have you built it for? So,
Okay, so that's answered, I believe. Next question is, so we have Pushpesh, just for your information, we have 30 plus questions right now for you. So I don't know how much we'll be able to cover. So let's try to, do as quickly as possible. So another question from Aditya G is, I had a broader question in general. Okay. Is it possible to take up engineering even today, even when you have absolutely 0% knowledge about computer programming or software, as both of them have become more and more related? So is it possible to take up engineering even today, even if you mean computer science engineering without knowledge of computer science? The answer is yes, Aditya. We have already discussed that. So Pushpesh is the best example, actually. He didn't have any background of computer science and he landed up in getting IIT Kharagpur computer science. So absolutely no requirement is, mandatory for getting computer science in engineering. I think Pushpesh will resonate with me, right?
Yeah.
So there is no prerequisite as such that you must be having coding in your undergrad, senior secondary to get computer science in college. No correlation. Yes, it might get you direct correlation at all. You might get a little bit of comfort in first year. You can do a little bit of extra curricular activities because you will be knowing computer science a bit. That's the only advantage. But otherwise, it's absolutely fine. Yeah. Next question is from Shivam. And the question is, are the games made by you having time limits, like you can't play for more than 20 minutes? This is because playing games on a small screen can damage eyes. So to prevent that, do you have time limits for playing the games? Do you support having time limits on the games made by you? If not, why? So you are in a fixed push space. So this is an ethical question now. So he's in grade 9, just to tell you this, and a very avid, interested person in mathematics. But so this is a question now. How do you answer this?
Fair enough. So yes, you should not play for too long. As I said, too much of anything is bad. And I mean anything. We do not directly apply the time limit because, again, the games that, or the basic philosophy is that, it's a free market, but we at the same time don't suggest people to kind of keep playing for longer or keep coming back and doing this. It is what the kind of games we make or what we believe in general is for casual gameplay. We rather optimize for gameplays when people are actually commuting, when they are waiting for their bus or the train or the taxi, etc., then that 5 minutes can they play quickly. And the games that we make is generally tuned for that, the games the levels do end or the session that ends. That, okay, if you started a game or a war or even in PUBG, for example, the games do end at that session. So that has to be short enough so that people can get that bite-sized entertainment. But we never will push you, or we never pushed by, like, okay, in general, to keep making you play again and again or do this. At the same time, like, okay, it is in India, government doesn't mandate this yet. In China, it is mandated for certain kinds of games, by the way, for PUBG kind of games and etc. as well, like where school kids are, like, okay, below certain age or below certain grade, you are not supposed to play more than this and all that. In India, unluckily, there is no law yet which is enforced.
So today we have some limits, and that limit is zero. So PUBG is totally banned. So hence there is no.
But that is not benef- that is not yes. for the benefit of.
Yes, yes. I totally get the point. So hence, guys, again, it's like, you know, as a mechanical engineer, I have to answer this question. So do you put governors on your car engines? So let's say to avoid accidents, what you can do is fix the upper limit of a car's RPM. Let's say. Okay, so that the vehicle doesn't cross the barrier of 60 kilometers per hour. Will that be a good thing to do? So it's as I think. I don't know whether I'm right in this case, but I think this is the same question there. So you give the consumer the opportunity. It's easier. For that matter, you know, again, the same principle holds. Anything bad, anything excessive is bad. So you decide your limit depending upon what context, what background you are from. Okay, so yes, the next question here is, do you personally think it's directed to both of us, Pushpace. Personally think college is important or branch is important when we finalize on engineering course. So I have been answering this question off late. And so we would like to listen from you. So what's your take on this? So how to optimize between college versus a branch?
My first thing will be college is more important than branch.
Yeah,
and branch is also important. Not saying that it's not important at all, but if I have to just order them, like, okay, I'll put college above branch, because you can learn more or less whatever is in branch. And, like, okay, currently in job market in corporate sector, it's not that, oh, if you're not from this branch, then you can't apply for this job. Those restrictions are gone. There's no restrictions anymore, and it's even more true in computer science. Like, okay, we never look at, okay, which department the candidate graduated from or has major in. We just look at what is his programming skills are like, his or hers credentials, like what kind of work he or she have done in the previous role, previous company, previous project, what have they built. And it doesn't matter which department you come from. Yes, college sometimes helps as a proxy for figuring out that, okay, what level of, like, okay, what kind of group that person belonged to. So obviously that's a filter, that's not a major thing to decide that, okay, this person is great or not. It's just a filter sometimes when you're looking at hundreds of profiles, etc. I have seen great programmers come out of nowhere. They, like, okay, were just great, like, okay, colleges which I have not heard of or which I had not heard of, and then, like, okay, some ITNs or, like, okay, interviews that I've done from, like, really premier institutes and premier departments of that, and those kids did not know anything, or, like, they were clearly in the wrong department and, like, in the wrong kind of career path. So
yeah, so at least in India, I have been also recommending the same thing. Thankfully we resonate on this, Pushpace, that college choice is better than branch choice at this undergrad level, at least. Because as I have been repeatedly telling that none of us actually knew what exactly this course is about. So hence, a right college will always give you that ecosystem, the people, as Pushpesh was mentioning in the initial phase of this session, that ecosystem and the people you are around with is very, very important. So if you are surrounded with smartest of the lot, that will give you enough push to rediscover yourself, maybe. So hence,
and also I would say, like, just one extra thing, that, okay, it depends on what, like, okay, I am assuming that, okay, generally when we do not have clarity on that, okay, which branch or what do we want to do when we're joining undergrad college, right? At that time, choose college over branch in general. But if you have absolute clarity that, okay, what you want to learn, at least, like, okay, you know that, okay, I want to learn VLSI chip design, or I want to learn how mechanical engineering inside mechanical engineering, what like this
particular automobile part. Engineering or something.
Yeah, so something like that. So then if you want to learn automobile engineering or aero space, anything of that sort, right? Aeromechanical or aerodynamic, all that kind of fluid dynamics, all then obviously then you should choose that branch very particularly. Then you should not just choose computer science and you are interested in fluid dynamics and you're choosing computer science, and it doesn't help. Computer science is a little bit more generic skill now, so it is easier to pick up. And easier to pick up as in like there is a lot of material, but there are certain things for which you can't just learn online, like VLSI chip design. You can't learn online only. You need access to labs. You need access to those professors. You need access to that. You need to go through steps. And that's where I would say that, okay, if you have clarity, which branch, which exact specialization or field that you are interested in, then obviously figure out which branch is better. Where will you get that in which branch and which college has the best branch. But if you don't have that, and if you want to be more on the computer programming side, that okay, I want to get into software anyway because I'm good at it, but I have to choose computer science in this college versus some other branch in this premier college, then choose the premier college because you can learn programming nonetheless. It's easy.
So moving on, Pushpesh, so we have now flurry of questions for you. It seems you are, you know, you have hit the right chord, it seems. Now, the next question is from Himanshu. He says, do the computer science courses in India teach coding required for product development?
No.
So it's a blunt answer.
They don't.
Himanshu, just to answer your query, they don't really teach you. Yes, I would tell you, for example, from my experience, for example, in mechanical engineering, there was a cold course called ITPL. ITPR, Information Technology for Product Realization. So in that course, we studied the basics, as in, you know, the construct of it. So they never said, ki, go and learn AutoCAD or, you know, some Inventor or Maya or this and that. They just gave the overview, the backbone structure of it. And then, yes, there will be projects around it, but they will not teach how to implement that. So
So but that's my pet peeve with Indian or like even in IITs and NITs and all that, like the premier institutes, I still have this pet peeve that okay, they don't update the curriculum, because the computer programming product development now in India, product development scene has just changed dramatically in last 5, 6, 7 years, right? But curriculums have not changed. Mm-hmm. And like, okay, people are still in all the colleges in India in curriculum. They are being taught very simple things and not kind of
industry ready.
Not industry ready. Not so that part you have to do it on your own, and no matter which college you go. And that's why it's important that okay, your friend circle or your peer circle, which is in the college, is like, yes, that, where you will get pushed. You will see that okay, how people are learning online, how people are kind of doing more than what the curriculum is asking them to. And that will push you to learn and grow faster and ask the right questions at the right places.
Yeah.
So that's super important.
Yeah. So for example, all these softwares, let's say if you want to do a course on Adobe's this thing, right? So there's a Premiere Pro, there is After Effects and all this, let's say you are interested in knowing. So in India, in our regular coursework, this is not there. So you have to be, and hence the important point. So for example, I learned Photoshop in my college, seeing my seniors doing working on it. That's it.
Yeah.
So there was no Photoshop tutorial given by my college. No. So hence we learned from our peers and then started, you know, doing hands-on and things like that.
And it depends on you. Like, okay, I'll give you a brief example from my college, like my computer science college. Like, okay, in our computer science college in Kharagpur, we were never taught a programming language. Actually, the only programming language we were taught was C. Not even C++. So C, which is the most basic language in that sense. But because it makes you think computer science concepts into programming. So that way it was important. But we used to get assignments, which was to build full softwares of something and et cetera. And that was in Java. And we were never taught Java. What, like, the course was not about Java, but like the whole program, assignments and semester projects were all to be done in Java or some other language, et cetera. And it was expected that okay, you will go and learn it on your own. So I don't know if today's college and today's curriculums or today's those professors, certain professors might be still doing that in today's world, which is, if you get to that, that is great. But otherwise, you have to do it. Like, you should try to learn 5 different languages or 3 different languages at least in your college, try to do those projects or semester projects or pick up your own projects and do it in different languages just for the heck of it, just for the sake of learning. Because that will open your mind, make you ask different kind of questions, make you grasp the computer science concepts even better. And even if you're not from computer science, you will start asking those questions which you can ask and just pick up a book and read about it.
Yeah. Next question to you is from Pranav. He's asking, sir, your merit, intelligence, and definitely a certain amount of luck in your favor has helped you become successful in the gaming sector. But how viable is it as a career if you look at it otherwise? So I don't know what exactly you mean, Pranav, here, but then yeah, all these things are vital for any particular field. It's not limited to only gaming industry. So whether you want to become a good coder or an Air Force pilot or, you know, whatever. So everywhere your merit, intelligence, and a certain amount of luck will place you. But then I have a feeling that even your luck is a function of how much effort you have put in. So, you know, as we say, fortune favors the brave. And in my example, at least in my career, I hope Pushpace will resonate with me in this, that if you're really putting in your, you know, real effort, luck will assist you. So your efforts, you know, energy you are putting in, according to the laws of thermodynamics, it is going to come back to you. It's not going to get destroyed. So be, you know, just relax and pursue your whatever field you want to pursue. That's it. So I think I answer the question from
perspective. Yeah, so don't put too much expectations. Try to draw a line that you can
just your future. Example itself, Pushpace, for example, when you know during we are batchmates and Pushpace landed up in one of the finest companies through campus placement. It was the top investment banking bank, I think, that time during our time. Lehman Brothers was on the top, you know. So if and we used to really, so we had a trend of in our college that whenever you get a job, you get to treat others. And I believe Pushpace is the treats value was dependent or a function of how much is the package someone is earning. And I really remember that Pushpace's treat was the biggest treat because he had got the, but then turnaround happened and there was a crash in the market. And then he had to switch over to a completely new field and he started from scratch and now today is one of the finest game developers.
Even post that, right? Like I'm not a gamer. I was not a gamer in that sense and I never envisioned myself to be in game development. It's just that I was after that's true for me, but I was not after game development. I was after that product. Thrill and the satisfaction of product development for consumers where I can push things or I can develop things faster and see their expressions, learn from the mistakes, make my code better, make my product better, etc. So that whole feedback loop had to be fast. That was my only requirement and that I liked. And that's why I stuck to gaming for so long because it serves that purpose. It gives me that, my intellectual stimulation keeps on happening on a daily basis, even still, because every day you learn something new because your user has never used this product earlier. So something like that. I believe that, luck is an important factor no matter what. You can't really, if luck was never there, then you can exactly plan where you will be 20 years down the line and you can do everything. But no, life doesn't work that way. Mm-hmm. You have to be open for certain serendipitous moments, certain things, certain twists and turns. Like nobody could have predicted coronavirus to happen. Certain industries will get wiped out. Certain new industries will just come up. So nobody can plan for these things. What you can just do is keep focusing on your skill, identify and keep figuring out what you're good at. Figuring out what you're good at and continue on that path. And because if you're good at something, you will most probably be fine. You will be fine, no matter what, where the world goes. If you're not good at something or if you're good at whatever you were good at, that thing doesn't exist and you have not kind of changed yourself, you have not upskilled yourself, then you will be in trouble. And you don't have to worry about success. You just worry about learning and the skill development and all that stuff. Then everything else will happen and that we all call as luck.
Great. Now there's another question related to game only. So what are the key features to make your game fast moving or popular? So this is something you must have done a lot of brainstorming on maybe.
So there's no direct answer. Though I actually was thinking about giving, if any one of you are ever trying to make a game just for even learning or just for trying it out and all that, do not make a game for yourself. Means if you actually want to do it as a business, and this is true for any product that you will ever make, any business that you will ever make, do not make it with yourself, for yourself. Like, we all get in that kind of closed loop of like, oh, but I like it, this will be so great. Or like, okay, you have a small friend circle and all of you are like, okay, great, this is such a great idea. If the character can jump like this, right? It's so amazing it will be, because and you will develop it and then you will push it or kind of give it to someone else or show it to someone outside your friend circle, and that guy will like, what the hell is this? Or what is this? I don't understand. I don't like. And that happens in consumer space in games a lot. So that's why the thumb rule is never build a game for yourself or your close this thing, because you are biased. Whatever idea you will come up with, you are biased already because you think this is the greatest idea ever. So always think of whom are you building it for? Who's the user of this game? Are you building it for school kids? Are you building it for like certain kinds of audience? Like, are you building it for tier two town male audience who are between 35 to 60 years age? Like, we get to that level and we have to. Are we building for girls or female audience who are between 35 to 55 age in tier A towns, who have a credit card or who have access to payment? So this tells us that we don't put this feature or don't do this and do that. So always know your customers. So KYC, know your customer, build the product only for them, and then you will have a harder, better chance of success. Otherwise, you will have like near 99% probability
of. Yes, there is some again. I'm sorry for that network glitch.
Maybe. In game.
Yeah, sorry. So there is some network issue, network glitch. Pushpesh, can you hear me? Yeah. Is it fine now? So we had some issue with the network. Yeah. Are we okay here?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. No idea. So, like, did my answer complete or like?
Yeah. I think more or less it is done. So let's move on, because we are also running short of time now. So this is which is a very philosophical question. Which is more important, idea or the skills? So I would push space first you. So maybe I can add them later on. So the question is whether ideas are important or skills are important. So it's like asking whether a brain is important or heart is important, right? So I don't know. But my answer would be that you know, both are needed, you know, and without anything, the other one is not, what do you say?
Skills.
So Pushpesh is rating.
No, it's not. Okay. I believe idea. Yeah.
Go ahead, Pushpesh. Sorry.
Yeah, I believe idea is overrated.
Okay.
Means point is, ideas are great. You have to come up with lots of ideas, but you can't get married to an idea. Ideas should evolve. You build something, you see how users are using it, you see what happened, you learn from it, you change the idea, like whether 10%, whether 50%, 100%, something of that sort. Skills are 100% yours. The skills are something which are hard, this thing. Like, you learn it and you become better, you will know. And then you will be able to execute any idea better.
Okay, great.
People generally feel that, okay, like Dhirubhai Ambani had this great idea, or this successful person like Jamshedji Tata had this great idea, that's why they're successful. No, they are successful because of their skills, not because of their idea, because most probably what they started with would have changed.
Yes.
They would have started with, Dhirubhai Ambani started with, I think, selling cloths or saris or something of that sort. Like, but he didn't start with oil. He didn't start with Jio. See where the world is today. So it's because of skills you change the world or you become better. Ideas come and go.
Great. So hence, now the answers. So I would suggest, or I would say, that it actually matters a lot from person to person. So for example, if I ask me, I would say that both are important, because to learn a new skill also is an idea. Correct. So hence, that's my take would be that, yes, you have to have both together, but only ideas, no skill, flop show. No idea, In fact, you can't have skills if you don't have an idea. So my take would be like that. So let's keep it like this, because we have now 10 more questions, I believe, to answer. One is, in multiplayer games, is there a method where each player has a unique code, since single player games are pirated at a large scale? Also, for 3D game development, is Unreal Engine preferred over Unity? My God. So frankly speaking, Pushpace, when I was in grade 9 and 10, I had no clue whatsoever these kids are now talking
neither,
about.
Neither me.
So, but anyways, not
I
that today
understand.
I am.
Yeah.
So anyways, the answer, the question I'll repeat, is there a method where each player has a unique code in multiplayer games? Since single player games are pirated at a large scale, point number one. Point number two is, 3D game development is Unreal Engine more preferred over Unity?
Yeah. So first part, I could not fully understand what you mean. Okay, games are like softwares are pirated, no matter they're multiplayer or single player. Multiplayer games require a server. Single player games don't require a server sometimes. So that's why it feels that way. But it is not that multiplayer versus single player. It is which are the games which have server side stuff, which are the games which do not have any server side stuff. As we call it, server authoritative or client authoritative games. So accordingly, so that is not dependent. It's true with any software, for example. Second part, Unreal is better for 3D games, but for heavy games, for console games, yeah, Unreal is better. I have never used Unreal, so I can't really judge. Unity is good to start with more cheaply, more easily. Unreal requires little more dedicated hardware and stuff.
Okay, so I hope this is answered. Then we have, what challenges do you see for the gaming market to evolve in India? So this is like entrepreneur kind of a, you must have answered this to your investors maybe.
Two parts. In India, gaming today means multiple things. In India, gaming means Dream 11 as well. And MPL Dream 11 is everywhere, right? So we don't call that gaming, at least from our definition of it. Like, we are more casual gaming where people can play for free and there is no money involved. We are not for money, the games for entertainment. I believe games are actually a very basic human needs, because entertainment is a basic human needs. We all watch that cringy Bollywood movie. We may not watch it and we may not enjoy it. But those movies make 100 crores, 500 crores and all that. So there are people, Indians, watching it because it serves the need for entertainment. And people are ready to pay that 200 rupees, 300 rupees for that 3 hours, 2 hours of entertainment. We do that somewhere else. We go for a game of bowling and or something else, or foosball or whatever. You can spend 200, 300 rupees for that 1 hour of gameplay. So it is very natural. So the mobile games or console games are also exactly that, serving the same human need that they need. Humans need entertainment, and games are a way to express it. Active entertainment, because movies and TV shows and Netflix, everything is passive entertainment, because you're watching, you're not doing anything. Games are active, so it is even more intellectually stimulating. So that is there. So we believe, or we are on the side of games for entertainment. I think that part will remain, because India has so many people, so many humans. So we all have same needs, no matter you, me, people here on Zoom call, or people in villages, etc. It's just that they might be serving it using those entertainment needs using a physical game right now. Physical carom game or a cardboard, card game or a Ludo game, etc. Right? So it's the same need. If they have access to play Ludo on their mobile phone and they know how to play it and somebody teaches them or they learn it, then they will play that also, because they are playing it in real life as well. So that's why Ludo is so popular in India, right? So that's how I believe. And Dream 11 and those kind of games, which are more transactional, people are playing them for money or making money. That's a very different thing. I don't know what is the future of that or where it will go. But on the games as entertainment part, that is a basic human need. So it will only increase in India, because we as Indians or our society is not really game friendly. Games are looked down upon. All of you also know this, that you would have been scolded by parents and teachers and all that for playing too much games, which is there. But slowly, I think it will get to a place where everybody understands the value of it, and we understand as a society which are good games, which are the right things, which are the skills to be developed using that. And the right balance is what is obviously important.
Great. Now this Pushpace, get ready for another very technically heavy question, and I get no clue for this as well. So if we want to view the ads which come as pop-ups in games. How do we know that it's not a clickbait? So this is the question.
Yeah.
So if you want to view the ads which come as pop-ups in games, how do we know that it is not a... What is a clickbait, by the way? I'm
trying to understand what the exact question is, because clickbait is generally like, okay, something which some misguided or misleading title or misleading image in the ad or whatever, or in an article, which makes you click it. So it's a bait to make you click, right? So if there are ads obviously which will be clickbaits, as in like, okay, they are misguided, they are telling you something to get click to know more, and then you click on it, so that's a clickbait. There is no way to know, it's a quality control thing, right? Like, okay, people will misuse it with the ad maker or whoever's ad it is. They are trying to get clicks. It's same as news channel these days, right? Or news articles which are in the paper or in online papers.
Paid news kind of
thing. Like, they are putting something as the headline, but the content means something is not else, there, right? Yeah. Yeah, it's like breaking news. Like, okay, oh, there is a breaking news, there is a huge finding, and then you listen for next 15, 20, 30 minutes, and there is nothing. Nothing new. So that is a clickbait in that sense. There's no way to find it. It's just quality control. You don't click on it, and if enough people don't click on it, then automatically that will get flushed out of the system. If too many people click on it, then obviously there will be more of it in the system.
And you can always, after clicking, you do this social work of, what is that?
Yeah, you can market as
spam. Market as spam or something like that. Then you will do a social work for others as well. So we are extremely sorry, we are running short of time because Pushpace has some other engagements as well. So I have few more questions. Probably Pushpace, we have 5 minutes to answer them. Otherwise, okay. So I'll just read through the questions and maybe we can summarize everything. So let me read out the questions which have been posted so far. So the first question is from Shitij, who says, when we design a game, how can we design realistic graphics and at the same time keep the game engine from bugging out since many sprites are loaded at once?
So I got it.
Okay, so this is one question. Let me read out others so that we can club together. So this is related to the graphics and the hardware. I don't know. Well, you might have understood this. Next question is how to publish games on Google Play Store. That's a very standard answer. Mm. Even I have tried it. So Giridhar, who is this? I don't know the name of the student. Aditya, sorry. So I can answer that. So no worries. And then have you made any games related to studies, like some games in which you ask questions to a child according to their grade so that the students can learn while playing? Yes, I am developing it. Shivam, wait for some time and you'll get that app. Okay. So just to add answer, this is not related to Pushpay. So I'll, direct those questions which he can answer and probably we cannot take. So sir, I have a question. If now people want more of negative type games, what is negative? Like PUBG involving shooting and stuff. Okay, this is called negative type. We don't want to give such games to the world. So how do we make it both wanted and good? So this is again an ethical side of the gaming. Okay, we'll come to that. And the last one is, by the time we finish grads, don't you think that the computer science will be basic knowledge and we need to have at least another major branch knowledge like biomedics, etc.? Okay, so the question directed to Pushpesh would be the Chitish's question, which is, when we design a game, how can we design realistic graphics and at the same time keep the game engine from bugging out since many sprites are loaded at once? So
I'll try to answer the first one, the last one, because in the middle was simple ones.
But I'll
Analyze
later too. No problem.
Yeah. So the first one, how do you improve the performance or make sure that sprites don't crash the game? You are not overloading the memory and all that. That is too technical, and you can Google it. But obviously you know the problem right now. If loading too many sprites or loading too realistic characters which will have too many triangles and quads will lead to a lot of performance requirement on your phone or in PC, because try to think in computer science terms, basics. There are only three things in computer science that you ever need to learn. One is CPU, one is memory, one is network, which is your internet, the networks. That's it. Everything is function of these three variables and nothing else. So if you load too much sprite, too many assets, too much, lot of images, then you are loading the CPU. CPU means GPU as well, and loading the memory. So you will get bottlenecked. If you're doing it on a phone which has 1 GB RAM, then 1 GB memory versus a newer iPhone or a Samsung Galaxy, then you have more. So try to see which bottlenecks are you hitting and improve that, and you will be fine. The last one that, okay, like maybe computer science will become just a another like basic science or basic thing that you need to read. And like, what about the newer upcoming fields, right? I'll say like a little differently. Like, I don't think computer science will become the basic need. Programming will become the basic need.
Yeah.
And that is little different. You like programming means you just try to whatever ideas are in your head, or you know that, okay, this is the logic. I want this to happen when this happens. And you try to write a program to mimic that thought process, that logic, that idea. That is programming. In that, you are not really worried about, okay, how will this program run? Where I need to run it? Because that part is going to get commoditized. All of us have access to computing systems now. Like, for example, in our times when we were in college, we used to cross that lab all the time and look in, like, if we ever get access, which was the supercomputer lab. IIT Kharagpur used to have one of very few in India. Yes, Param 10,000. And we used to look at, like, what kind of program can we write? When can we write? Which can run on this? And today, in the whole world, supercomputers are dead. Like, more or less dead, because you can do it right on the mobile phones. As in, like, all the mobile phones in the world combined together are far, far more than, like, okay, computing power than supercomputers. So that has changed. Programming has become simpler and commodity. Computer science is now like basics. Like, okay, that comes as hardware. Like, nobody is worried about how cellular towers are working, right? You just try to make an app on your phone. You're not worried about, okay, how my app is talking to the towers and how it's switching while I'm in a taxi. You're not worried about that. So computer science will be that. But yes, there are newer fields which are coming up. Biomedicals can be that. There can be like newer technologies in biogenetics to even artificial intelligence. Very specific things will come. In computing, quantum computing is coming, or at least the world is going to move in that direction. So there will be newer fields. You just have to keep your eyes open. And that is a very good that, okay, if you think like that, that, okay, I have to learn something new to be relevant tomorrow. And that is the stance everyone should have. And not be just content with, okay, my course is done. Oh, I have finished my engineering, or my education days are over. No, it's not over. It's not going to be over, because world will change faster than what we can imagine. I never imagined my parents will ever shop anything digitally. Like, I never thought that, okay, in India, anybody will shop vegetables without touching them. And trust me, okay, the older people, okay, cannot imagine. And today, see, that's no longer an issue.
Yes.
Everywhere. Like, my mom and dad are buying stuff online, and even vegetables online, which is like, okay, I could not have imagined.
And they would have so never 10 years later, doing it.
Yeah. And 10, 20 years later, I don't know what will be the state. We will always get surprised. So be open to that. And
these people are going to surprise us more now. So
yes.
You know, 20 years down the line, when you guys will be coming online and giving us funda. So we are just hoping for that. So thanks a lot, Pushpesh, for all those insights. One very vital question, which is always there in the minds of all the students, and see the timing, and he has asked it, and he is asking, sir, do you offer internships for freshers? So that's the Moon Frog Lab does provide internship. Obviously, you have to be very good at it, and they are the finest bunch of people, at least in the city, who are really doing amazing jobs. So if you think that you have that thing in you and you really want to, you know, but obviously you have to go through a testing or something, some mechanisms would be there, I think.
Yeah.
So we can come up with, I will discuss with Pushpesh, and if at all there is any possibility of, I would love to see that happening, but yes, obviously a company has its limitations and aspirations, and, you know, it should match and gel with your skill set as well. So we'll see how feasible is it, and we'll definitely come back to you on that. So rest of the questions which we could not answer, don't worry, guys. We will try and answer them, as you know, because we are, as I told you, Pushpesh has another engagement right now after this. So we will not, hold him up here. So thanks a lot. My deepest gratitude towards, you know, you spared some time from your busy schedule. You came over, guided our students, and, you know, gave a lot of insights, many of things which I was myself not knowing. So thanks a lot for that. And I think, just give a great cheer to Pushpesh by saying, you know, thumbs up or something on the, you know, the common chat box, so that we can also understand whether you love the session. And we can, again, you know, bring some more experts on this platform and talk about their career and their profession. So, guys, so 3 cheers to Pushpesh. Thanks a lot. And if you liked it, just give a thumbs up in the chat box. Thank you so much, Pushpesh. And it was really,
Thanks, really
great, insightful discussion. I hope it was useful for our students community as well.
Yeah, I hope to too. I hope as well. Okay, if anybody, obviously, I hope that it was relevant, and I am super glad to see people are like, you know, younger generation is so enthusiastic about a lot of things, and they know far more than what we used to know, or I used to know at this age. So yeah, it's future is bright in that sense. Like, okay, feel free to pass on questions to Tushar or to me. You can obviously find me on social media. So like, not on Facebook, like, okay, I don't use it. So yeah, if, the best way, if somebody wants an advice, drop me a note on LinkedIn. Yeah. And yeah, happy to help.
So yeah, so you can find him on LinkedIn. His I think his handle would be what, Pushpesh Kumar Pushpesh.
Yeah. So if you just search Pushpesh, you will.
Yeah, so just Moonfrog Pushpesh. If you do a search on Google itself, you'll get it. So you can directly establish this thing. If you have it in you, he's a very open-minded, very welcoming person. I know at least. So if really you are doing wonderful job, he will himself probably would like love to have intelligent people with real great ideas. So good that you were here, Pushpesh. I really thanks once again. So see you again. Right. And bye-bye, guys. Good night to all of you. Stay safe.
Guys.
And yeah, take care. Bye-bye.